गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी. टुडेज टॉपिक इज ऑन न्यूरोक्रिस्टोपैथीज इंक्लूडिंग द स्पेक्ट्रम प्रेजेंटेशन एंड मैनेजमेंट ऑफ दीज कंडीशंस. न्यूरोक्रिस्टोपैथी द टर्मिनोलॉजी वॉज फर्स्ट कॉइन्ड बाय बुलांडे इन 1974 इन विच ही यूनिफाइड द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ ऑल कंडीशंस अराइजिंग फ्रॉम डिस्टर्बेंस ऑफ सेलुलर डेवलपमेंट एंड टिश्यू ऑफ न्यूरल क्रेस्ट ओरिजिन. दीज कंडीशंस प्रेजेंटेड विद वेरिड क्लिनिकल फिनोटाइप्स. So we will first briefly go through the etiology of neural crest cells. Neural crest cells are those that arise from the dorsal part of neural tube during neurulation, and these are unique cells which undergo epithelial to mesenchymal transformation, and then they detach from the neural tube, shown here, and migrate to specific locations along well-defined pathways, and these are guided by several local factors, and this migration occurs in a craniocaudal wave. They then differentiate into a variety of structure depending on their site of migration. So based on this, the craniocaudal migration theory, this was proposed by Okamoto and Ueda in 1967. They reported using 18 human embryos and fetuses from varying gestation ages from 5 weeks to 9 months, and they studied that the myenteric plexus was formed by neuroblasts which were distributed throughout the gastrointestinal tract by craniocaudal migration from the 5th to 12th week of gestation. So based on these, as shown here, then in the 5th weeks, they noticed that the vagal trunks were formed predominantly in the upper esophagus, and the sympathetic ganglionated chains were formed there. Immature ganglion cells were present and neuroblasts were present. Around 6th week, these neuroblasts were formed along the esophagus outside, migrated up to the circular muscles and present up to the cardia of the stomach. By 7 weeks, they were noticed below the corpus of the stomach up to the cephalic limb of the midgut, and also present within the submucal plexus. By 8th week, the neuroblasts were present in most of the intestine except the distal colon and rectum, and by 12th week, neuroblasts were present in all parts of the intestine till the rectum and in the submucosal plexus. So this was the theory that based on these findings, they suggested that Hirschsprung disease was a developmental anomaly in which the developmental process, this development migration process, would be seized at various levels. Earlier the cessation of the migration, longer would be the segment of aganglionosis. The enteric nervous system is formed by neural crest cells mainly from the vagal region and the sacral region, but majority of it is from the vagal outflow. There's another theory proposed by Nishiyama et al. They demonstrated the transmesenteric migration using time-lapse imaging analysis in mouse neural crest cells. So they noticed that the neural crest cells crossed the midgut to the hindgut via the mesentery when the midgut and hindgut were transiently placed adjacent to each other during development. So the neural crest cells took sort of a shortcut from the midgut to the hindgut, and this was glial-dependent neurotropic factor signaling dependent. So this could the delayed transmesenteric migration could lead to impaired colonization of the hindgut, which can be a part of pathogenesis of Hirschsprung disease, and this could also explain skip lesions which is rarely seen in Hirschsprung disease. Also, another theory is change of microenvironment, where high laminin levels may be present in the local environment, making the gut non-permissive to migrating neural crest cells. So the neural crest cells, maybe cranial or vagal or sacral, as we saw, they differentiate into a variety of tissues, as shown here, including components of the eye, the cranial neural crest, connective tissues around the eye, optic nerves, muscles of the iris and ciliary body, dermal bones of the skull, conotruncal septum, the pharyngeal arches, cartilages, odontoblasts, dermis of the head and neck, and some cranial nerve ganglia. They also form the peripheral glial cells in the peripheral ganglions, melanocytes, enteric ganglia, Schwann cells, then again pre and paravertebral ganglia, adrenal medulla, and the dorsal root ganglia neuroblasts. So, since they have such a variety of differentiation, the manifestations phenotypically of neurocrystopathies will involve all these structures. We'll see them ahead. Neurocrystopathies initially were broadly classified into two basic forms, the simple neurocrystopathy or complex neurocrystopathy. Simple included only single pathologic processes. They were unifocal and localized diseases. Complex or neurocrystopathy syndromes are multifocal and with varied association. In 1997, with the increasing number of neurocrystopathies being described to more than 20, Volande reclassified them into, again, more subsets in the simple neurocrystopathy, including dysgenetic neurocrystopathy, where congenital malformations were present because of derangement of the neural crest cells, migration, colonization, or cytodifferentiation, and neoplastic neurocrystopathy, where true neoplasms or pre-neoplastic hyperplasias or hematomas were associated with it. And complex remain the same, that is combined dysgenetic and neoplastic would be seen and occurring at multiple sites. So this is a table showing the major neurocrystopathies. It's a very exhaustive list where dysgenetic includes hyperpigmentary disorders, hypopigmentary disorders like Pebaldism, Hirschsprung disease, intestinal neuronal dysplasia, and several syndromic associations where there are craniofacial malformations of mesoectodermal origin. And neoplastic include neuroblastoma, pheochromocytoma, medullary carcinoma of thyroid, paragangliomas, as we all know, the Menn syndrome. And complex includes Waardenburg syndrome, DiGeorge syndrome and its variants, von Recklinghausen's disease, or Menn 2A, 2B. And other, we will subsequently discuss these. So Hirschsprung disease is a simple neurocrystopathy by definition, and it is also it also becomes a complex neurocrystopathy when it is associated with the neoplastic or non-neoplastic conditions as described earlier. So the reported associations with Hirschsprung disease include Waardenburg syndrome type 4 or the Waardenburg-Schar syndrome, neuroblastoma, Menn 2 syndrome, the congenital central hypoventilation syndrome, Yemeni deaf-blind hypopigmentation syndrome, Pebaldism, neurofibroma, or Rayleigh-Day syndrome. The genetic basis for neurocrystopathies associated with Hirschsprung disease, the major susceptibility genes are the RET gene, that is rearranged during transinfection, proto-oncogene, which is a proto-oncogene 10q11.2, the recessive EDNRB gene at 13 Q position of the chromosome, and its ligand, which is the endothelin 3, glial-derived neurotrophic factor. These are the four main major susceptibility gene, and the resulting neurocrystopathies can be classified based on this. First, discussing the ones associated with RET proto-oncogene, these are the Menn syndromes. The genetic association has to be identified early for preventive and early treatment strategies. So, in Hirschsprung, RET mutations which occur de novo are usually loss of function. They are seen in 50% familial and 30% non-familial cases. Whereas in Menn 2A and 2B, there is a gain of function mutation, especially in the cysteine-rich area of the extracellular domain. However, for both of them to co-occur, there are certain mutations which include co-segregation, where there is one such example is the C620S mutation or the Genus mutation, which is present up to 50% of the cases where Hirschsprung and Menn 2 syndromes occur together. These are the other. These are some of the other known mutations where there is co-occurrence of these two conditions. Discuss the Menn 2 syndromes now. They are most commonly autosomal dominant, and they have two subtypes. The Menn 2A syndrome is known as the Sippel syndrome. This includes heterozygous mutation in the RET oncogene, and they have characteristic age-related predisposition to medullary carcinoma of thyroid, 70% occurrence by 70 years of age, is in way to remember, and pheochromocytoma occurs in 50% of the cases. Parathyroid hyperplasia occurs in 15 to 35% of the cases. These in this syndrome, most of them are asymptomatic in the preclinical phase, and prevention mostly is by knowing the family pedigree, genetic analysis, and timely intervention. Because especially in Menn 2B, they can have lymph node metastasis at diagnosis in medullary carcinoma of thyroid. MEN2B syndrome is also a heterozygous mutation of the RET oncogene, and 95% of them have a specific mutation in exon 16 of RET, which is the M918T. This is the most aggressive subtype, and this is a hematoneoplastic syndrome where aggressive medullary carcinoma of thyroid occur without hypoparathyroidism. Pheochromocytoma is known to occur. Mucosal neuromas, thickened corneal nerves are other classical features. On physical examination, these children have full lips, thick eyelids, high arched palate, and a marfanoid habitus is seen in most of them. The median onset is about 10 years earlier than in MEN2A. And familial medullary carcinoma thyroid can be an isolated only phenotype as a part of MEN2A, and this is known as, this is the least aggressive form known. Diagnosis is by genetic testing, which has a high specificity of 95 to 100%. This is done less than before 1 year of age in MEN2B and before 5 years of age in MEN2A. The Janus gene, which I described earlier, is known to, it is done for risk stratification. It is associated with very high risk. There are also other classification for risk assessment based on the codons involved. High risk mutations, these are the codons involved, 634, 618, intermediate risk, and low risk. In MEN2B, again, as described earlier, the methionine to threonine substitution at 918 position of RET kinase domain. This is the most significant alteration. It has a very aggressive behavior. So, coming to Hirschsprung disease associated with MEN2, a systematic review by Coyle et al., including 300 odd patients with either Hirschsprung or MEN2A with a Janus mutation were studied. Co-occurrence occurred in about 25% of these cases, Hirschsprung alone in 20% and MEN2A alone in about 50%. So, the most common mutation they noted is the C620. So, higher incidence of long segment Hirschsprung and total colonic Hirschsprung disease is seen with these mutations. That has to be kept in mind. And Hirschsprung associated with MEN2B, there's only a single case report of chronic constipation with ganglioneuromatosis and rectosigmoid. So, it is a very rare association with MEN2B. So, treatment of MEN syndrome, the main cornerstone is prophylactic total thyroidectomy of the gene carriers following genetic evaluation. The genotype-based risk stratification is done. They're classified as high risk or moderate risk, and timing of surgery is less than 1 year in MEN2B as they have aggressive tumors. Hirschsprung with RET abnormalities, based on the risk profile, this is how, these are the ATA guidelines of 2015 for management. So, in the highest risk, which we described in MEN2B, it has to be done within the first year of life or the first few months after counseling the parents. And in high risk and moderate risk, in high risk before 5 years of age, and in moderate risk in MEN2A, it can be done when follow-up of calcitonin becomes elevated or in the childhood period itself to avoid a lengthy evaluation period. And follow-up is by serum calcitonin levels every 6 months in the first year and annually later. And we also begin screening them for pheochromocytoma at the age of 11. In the moderate risk or low risk, screening is started at 16 years of age. Intestinal ganglioneuromatosis. Ganglioneuromas affect the peripheral nerves in the intestinal wall. These are described with the MEN2 syndrome, or they may occur as an isolated condition and present with pseudo-obstruction. If they have abnormal neuropeptide secretion, for example, the vasoactive intestinal peptide, they may present with diarrhea, but most commonly are asymptomatic, and they may present also similar to Hirschsprung disease with failure to thrive and abdominal distension. On imaging, we find abnormal hostile patterns, thickened mucosal folds, colonic diverticuli may be present, and defective peristalsis will be seen. On rectal biopsy, massive transmural hypertrophy of nerve fibers are seen, especially among the autonomic ganglia, and increased S100 staining is seen in the mucosa muscularis propria. Ganglioneuromas of the enteric nerve system are rare. They have two morphological patterns, polypoid and diffuse. And in transmural, all layers of the bowel are affected with the neural hyperplasia, especially the myenteric plexus. And in mucosal form, they are polypoid and are associated with von Recklinghausen disease or adenocarcinoma colon. This is a case report, but of an adult patient. This is just to demonstrate the colonoscopic picture where there are how the ganglionomas will appear. And even on CT, there's an eccentric haustal fold thickening, and this is the histopathological finding. They present as polypoid mass with finger-like projection with positive staining for S100 as shown. Neurocrystopathy is crystinopathy associated with the endothelin system. This is the most common one is the Waardenburg syndrome, which classically presents with pigmentary anomalies and sensory neural hearing loss. This accounts for 2 to 5% of all congenital deafness. 1 in 40,000 to 50,000 live births is the incidence, and they have absence of melanocytes in the skin and stria vascularis of the cochlea, which accounts for the sensory neural hearing loss. So there are 4 genetic links described: the transcription factor from SOX10 gene, the endothelin 3, and the EDNRB gene, and the MITF gene. So with these genetic defects, it results in lack of the gene products needed for melanocyte formation. So there is a mutated melanocyte formation, which lead to the presentation. There are 4 main subtypes of Waardenburg syndrome. Type 1 will describe the diagnostic criteria for these in detail, but of importance to us is the type 4 or Shaw-Waardenburg syndrome, where autosomal recessive occurrence is there. This is a co-occurrence of Waardenburg syndrome with Hirschsprung disease. This again has 3 subtypes based on the genetic mutation seen. With only EDR and NRB gene, it is 4A. With endothelin 3 gene, it is B. And with SOX10, it is 4C. So this forms a diagnostic criteria. The major criteria include congenital sensory neural hearing loss with more than the hearing threshold of more than 25 decibel for at least 2 frequencies between 250 to 4000 hertz, and pigmentary disturbances of the iris. This may present as 2 eyes may be of different color, or heterochromia, which may be complete or segmental, and classic blue characteristic brilliant blue eyes, which are seen, which is also known as Waardenburg blue eye. The penetrance of this is 15 to 30%. And hair abnormalities is the third criteria, where a white forelock of hair may be seen. This may be present at birth and disappear later in life, or reappear in teen or adulthood, or they may be seen for the first time at any age. Also, body hair, eyebrows, and eyelashes, they may be white hypopigmentation. Dystopia canthorum, this has the highest penetrance of 98%. Waardenburg index is calculated based on the inter and outer canthal distances, and there's a formula for it. More than 1.95 is abnormal. And fifth criteria is the affected first degree relative. Minor criteria include congenital leucoderma with hypopigmented patches, median eyebrow flare, which is also known as sinophoris, a broad nasal ridge, and alar hypoplasia, and premature graying of hair. So for diagnosis of Waardenburg, we need to have 2 major criteria, one of which has to be dystopia canthorum, or 1 major and 2 minor criteria. So if it meets these diagnostic requirement, it will be the type 1. In subtype 2, there's absence of dystopia canthorum. In type 3, it will also have upper limb anomalies will be seen, maybe as formis contracture or limb deformities. And in Waardenburg syndrome, Hirschsprung disease has to be present. Treatment is mainly based on for hearing loss, amplification devices or frequency modulator systems or cochlear implants are given for prelingual deafness, and they're advised to avoid prolonged sun exposure. Physical therapy is aimed at providing good range of movement and fine motor functioning for these children, and management of Hirschsprung disease. But main is genetic counseling of the parents and screening of relatives. This is one of the children who presented to our hospital with Shaw-Waardenburg syndrome, other subtype 5. Child had Hirschsprung disease, long segment, type 4. This image shows lower limb deformity. This shows a hypopigmented patch we can see here, and a white forelock. Child also had iris heterochromia, blue iris. Next, neurocrystinopathy we'll be discussing is the congenital central hypoventilation syndrome, also known as Ondine's curse. This is a rare life-threatening condition where the child will have an abnormal ventilatory response to hypoxia and hypercapnia. There's a failure because of failure of the autonomic respiratory control. They are also known to have other autonomic disturbances, including reduced esophageal motility and heart rate control. And about 20% of these cases are associated with Hirschsprung disease. There's French registry has the largest record of these conditions. Unlike the altered sex ratio in Hirschsprung disease, in these it's known to be 1:1, equal male and female occurrence, and 1 in 2 lakh live births. Almost 60% of them had aganglionosis associated with a small bowel. That is, long segment or total colonic aganglionosis is known to occur. The genetic mutations are similar, multigenic RET and endothelin 3 mutations. Also described are de novo mutations of the FOX2B gene on chromosome number 4. This is known to be associated with neuroblastoma. And screening for patients, which is why we need to screen such patients for malignancy like neuroblastoma and ganglioneuroblastoma. The Haddad syndrome is a co-occurrence of that was described when Hirschsprung disease occurs with the central congenital central hypoventilation syndrome. This was first reported in 1978, and several case reports have been published since then. In 2019, there's a case report where FOX2B gene mutation was seen in about 10 children, with median age of presentation being 5 years. So these children required immediate ventilation care after birth in 5 of them. Tracheostomy was performed in 9 of them, and some of them required sleep ventilation, and 2 patients required continuous ventilatory support. So these are the cause of concerns in this syndrome, and 6 of them showed rectosigmoid aganglionosis, about 4 showed total colonic aganglionosis, and 1 of them had extended into the small bowel, aganglionosis extended to small bowel. Neuroblastoma, we all know, is the most frequent solid tumor of childhood, arising from anywhere, can arise anywhere in the sympathetic chain or adrenal medulla. This is known to occur associated with Hirschsprung and congenital central hypoventilation syndrome, as I mentioned earlier, and this includes heterogeneous mutations of the paired like homeobox2b gene, that's the FOX2b, and specific mutation seen is described as the PARM, that is polyalanine repeat expansion mutation. This presents with high risk neuroblastoma. So currently there are the 2020 recommendations for genetic screening in Hirschsprung disease is as shown in this table. In non-syndromic Hirschsprung, genetic testing of RET should be considered. This is level 2 to 3 evidence, and level of agreement is 100%. Because RET remains the major gene, even in non-syndromic, it has to be considered. Molecular testing will allow a more accurate estimation of the risk of occurrence, especially possibility of MEN2A syndrome and risk of medullary thyroid carcinoma in the later in life for these children. So parents or patients who wish to have screening should be offered and should be referred to a genetic consultant. And it is also recommended for patients with family history where RET mutations, incidence of RET mutations is even higher. So for syndromic Hirschsprung, they should be offered a referral for genetic consultation for specific gene and syndromic phenotype. This is level 3 evidence and with 100% agreement. So these are guidelines for routine screening in Hirschsprung disease. This table just presents a summary of everything we discussed currently. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vidya.
Thank you, sir.
You're mentioning of association. So, what's the purpose of this Krishnopathy evaluation for Krishnopathy or genetic evaluation? Like, how, what duration are you looking at for development of problems with Hirschsprung disease? Is there any available reports or case reports or series where this have developed, or is it just on now?
There are
isolated cases. With Krishnopathy is known. One, this is, as you mentioned, it's a simple or complex based on its association with other conditions. So, in a routine child getting operated, say rectosigmoid or a long segment or total TCA or TIA, what would be any references or any guidelines as to how the genetic and the sync testing should be proceeded with, or what would be the long-term implication beyond the bowel? I'm talking beyond the bowel function and outcomes beyond this.
They all may, in case of RET mutation, they all may present in adulthood with, especially with medullary carcinoma of thyroid,
Okay.
if
Any
missed during
available
childhood.
reports?
So I haven't found any. I haven't gone through.
So yeah, there are a couple with they're in the fifth decade. So now initially they used to say early occurrence, but now they're seeing the that's one from Rintala where they mentioned
Yes.
where they're looking at the fourth or fifth decade of life where operated a person with Hirschsprung's operating in his neonatal or childhood period going on to develop medullary carcinoma thyroid. So they are again screening with serum calcium is one and the zinc for medullary carcinoma, other one for that was mooted, but that again, as you mentioned, it is. But we have to look out for this. We need to keep them aware that
Yes.
long-term sequelae can occur beyond bowel function, and that is that's the need for this discussion. What you have mentioned in this, and as regards to Shaw-Waardenberg, what any surgical modality available for described?
For long segment or extended
Extended, yes.
myectomy has been described.
Myectomy by whom? For any name?
Intestinal transplant is one
Yeah,
option,
transplant is
sir.
one. Yes,
And
yes.
the other option is proximal jejunostomy with extensive myectomy is what they've tried before, but with poor
Yes.
results. But they have to be
Yes, poor
supported with
outcome.
parenteral nutrition.
Parenteral nutrition, yes. I'll open it for discussion, sir. Any further questions?
Yeah, that procedure which you asked was described by Ziegler.
Ziegler, yes.
Ziegler's procedure. It is
Yes.
not just myectomy, it is myectomy, myotomy, like that you do it. So you do 10, 10 to 15 centimeters of myectomy followed by, I think, about 30 centimeters of myotomy. That's how you do it. So he's accumulated a good number of cases. I don't know, I read it long back. So as Vinu mentioned, it has to be associated with jejunostomy has to be done with it very often,
Yes.
and rehabilitation is very tough in these patients.
Yes,
So in addition to that, once they have achieved a good length of intestine which can be utilized, then they can do the intestinal elongation procedures like the STEP procedure or the Bianchi procedure. All these things can be done.
Yes.
But if it is up to ligament of Treitz, then it is a very dismal situation. If it is, say, up to 10 to 15 centimeters from ligament of Treitz, then some salvage procedures can be done, and they can be made to survive on almost like 80% of enteral nutrition and 20% of parenteral nutrition, mainly during the night time.
Yes, sir.
Or they can be also be given what is called as an elemental diet.
Yeah.
What is described for space travel, no? That Y1X, that elemental diet can
Yes,
also be
yes.
prescribed for them.
Okay.
That is what is described.
Yes,
So in our Bangalore this thing reality, St. John's is doing some study. I don't know what study they are doing. What are they trying to study? Every time we ask for a frozen section or a pathological sampling of our patients, they will ask for Dr. Kinney will ask for a blood sample with the
Yes, sir.
patient. So what are they studying?
So, they're
Are
seeing
they studying
the.
the genetics? Are they studying the
No,
genetics?
they were looking at sterile choline stress levels, sir. That was the previous
In the blood,
study they
is
were
it?
doing.
In the
Yes,
blood they are doing?
they
Okay.
were looking at it as a screening modality. This was one concept which is mooted before,
Oh,
also
okay.
by a Japanese investigator, where
I
they
never
looked
probed
at.
into it. I thought they were doing some genetic study also.
But
That's what I was
no,
thinking.
they were doing a genetic study, less, sir. We were planning to do that with Dr. Meenakshi Bhat. But as far as Dr. Usha Kenny, madam, she published that paper, but the sensitivity also was not good. though they looked into it and saw that there was not much difference, they wanted to look at it as a screening tool. So if the child is suspected on X-ray or clinical, then do a Streptococcus test and blood on the blood, and then you go further work up on that. So that was the thing that they were doing, sir.
Dr. Anand Aladi is there. We can ask him if he has any points to make.
Sorry, I was actually listening when I was driving all the throughout the thing, so I was not able to see the slides. But I think, like Gauri pointed out, more important would be clinical applications of this, because whatever effort she has put in and made a very good presentation, but trying to remember all these things and trying to reproduce it will be like a short-term memory.
Yes.
So what is important is where putting a probably a slide or two at the end where you have clinical relevance in our day-to-day practice. So which are the groups of questions which we have to specifically look for certain things? What are the counseling and evaluation which we have from long-term point of view and short-term, and from subsequent generations for siblings and other outcomes?
Yes, sir.
So I think that should be like a carry home, take home message.
Yes.
As regards,
otherwise, whatever you have done, I think that's fine. Efforts have been good, and whatever you have summarized is.
Sir, Anand, sir, as regards to the genetic issue, we actually had discussion with Dr. Meenakshi, but initially, because we had this pool of patients of 150 odd children who had short, long term, and total colonic agenesis. So initially they said because of the wide variation, we may not be able to arrive at any thing. I wanted just at least to know what patterns they are in, but she said it may not be of clinical significance. But now, with the oncoming reports of carcinoma occurring at the fourth decade, at fifth decade, we may have to. As you said, that's one table which she summarized in the end. That I think that's where they say it needs to be offered if their parents want to know whether there is a future risk of development of the men's syndrome. That apart, there is no other recommendation just come. Or long-term calcium monitoring, that's what was referred to by Rinta group. And that's what's available.
And many of these are evolving things. So what would have been 5 years down the line, something would have changed. And as we go further down, things will keep adding on. What are we looking at? Both monitoring and prognostication.
Any other questions? Otherwise.
No, sir.
Okay, then if there is no more thing,
yes,
end the discussion. Thank you, sir.
Well presented, Vidya. Very
thank
nice.
You, sir.
It was good. Very good.
Thank you, sir.